Good morning, church. It's Thursday morning. We want to go to the book of Revelation in chapter number 12. We're getting into, again, some of this parenthetical statements that are made that helps us to understand the overview of what's going on. Remember, there is persecution going on earth and a lot of people dying. And now we're going to see why that is. In chapter number 12, verses 1 through 4, it says, "Now a great sign," and keep that in your mind, this is a sign, a symbol, it symbolizes something. "A great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Then, being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. And another sign appeared in heaven, behold, a great fiery red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on his head." Usually that means he has right to rule. He has a kingdom which he rules over. When he has more diadems, that means more nations or more kingdoms that he has under his authority. Verse number 4, "His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born." Well, this gives us an overview of the war that has been going on since Satan has rebelled against God in heaven. Now, in chapter number 12, we're going to get Satan's purpose in what he's doing in persecuting and harassing and so forth. And then in chapter 13, we'll get Satan's prince and Satan's prophet that we'll be introduced to as well. Now, it's quite obvious here that this great sign, that this person that they're talking about, this woman, is Israel. In fact, the only other mention in Scripture of the sun, moon, and 12 stars goes all the way back to Joseph's day, when Joseph had a dream, and his father, whose name was Israel, was Jacob, but then it was changed to Israel. And Jacob was the sun, and his mother, and Jacob, Joseph's mother was the moon. And then Joseph's 12 brothers are the stars, and it just represents Israel. That's made very plain as we go through here. And then it says that God was going to use her mightily, that she had much glory. Even as much as Israel has failed God, as many times as she has broken his covenants and gone, turned her back upon God and not served the Lord and even rejected her own Messiah, she still is God's beloved. And God still has a plan and a program for her. But Satan knows that. Satan knows from the time that God chose Abraham and how God showed favor to Abraham and what God has done for Israel throughout the history. Satan knows the prophecies as well as we do. And he knows that Israel is the one by which God would send the Messiah, but also that God would redeem the world and they would rule. And so whatever God loves, Satan's going to target and hate, and he's certainly going to do that during this tribulation period. Notice in verse number 2, it says, "being with child." And this is talking about a child that would be born to Israel, to the nation Israel. But it really goes back all the way to Genesis chapter number 3. Remember, there was a woman who was in battle with a serpent, and there was a woman and a serpent together there. Remember that? And that this woman was going to bring forth a child, the seed of the woman, who was going to crush the head of the serpent. And so this is the child that was to be born, that Christ that came forth from Israel. And all the prophets and all the scriptures of the Old Testament are pointing to this one who is to come, this child that is to be born, who would be the Redeemer, who would be the Messiah, who would be the King over all kings. And knowing all this, Satan has done his level best to try to prevent that numerous times. Of course, he tried back in the days when Israel went into Egypt and Pharaoh made the policy to kill all the boy children. Remember that? And to assimilate all the women into the Egyptian culture. Therefore, there would never be a nation Israel. He did that again through trying to have the Jews intermarry with the Canaanites. On numerous occasions, the prophets had to really berate the people and even cast out the people, excommunicate people, because they were marrying unbelievers, marrying the people of other nations, and therefore destroying the Jewish strain and the pure blood that would keep the covenant in place. Haman was one of those who tried to kill all the Jews. Then, of course, Antiochus Epiphanes. Then we had the ultimate one would be when Herod the Great was waiting for the child to be born, and he wanted to destroy the child and kill the child. So on that occasion, Satan used Herod the Great to try to kill the Messiah, and he ended up killing all the baby boys in Bethlehem. And so we see Satan's purpose is to destroy Israel and to keep God's Messiah from ever being born. But now we know he has been born, and there is a purpose. And Satan's still going to have a purpose in the future of trying to destroy Israel. And so that's what's going on in the tribulation period, is Satan turns his attention to the destruction of Israel once again, as he has done many times. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Pray for Israel. Pray that they might come to know their Savior, Jesus. Let us pray together. Father, we thank you that you've given us a very clear picture of those things that are happening and why you allow those things to happen. In all these times, throughout the history, we have seen the Jews being under heavy persecution. And Father, it breaks our hearts that people would treat one another that way. But Father, we recognize that Satan has such a hatred for your people, even us. Help us, Father, to be proud children of yours, that we might serve you fully and faithfully. In Jesus' name, amen.